you're ready to stand on the line, if you're ready to fight back and serve it to the criminals trying to enslave you and steal your wealth through monetary creation and exorbitant taxation, you're in the right place. Welcome back to another edition of the Prepper Recon Podcast. I've personally been buying gold and silver from JM Bullion for over 2 years. They offer the best prices over spot that I can find, and I've never had a problem with an order. If you're looking to trade in some of your fiat paper for real money, check out jmbullion.com today.
Our individual first aid kits are now on sale. They're Mali-compatible pouches in Coyote, ACU, OD, or Black. They're equipped with an Israeli battle dressing, quick clot, TK4 tourniquet, suture kit, and lots of extras. It's perfect for your car, bug-out bag, or home first aid kit. Go to the PrepperRecon.com homepage and click on the IFAC store tab at the top of the page. They're on sale for $89, and that includes shipping. This kit could save your life.
Hey, Preppers and Patriots. Today's show is going to be a little bit of a mix. I'm going to talk a little bit about my recent excursion to go look for some Florida hogs and the camping trip that went with that hog hunt. And then I'm also going to do a little gear review. I'm going to talk about some of the items that I took on the camping trip, what worked, what didn't. And we're also going to do a gear review for the Survival Bags Inc. Urban Operator Survival Bug Out Bag. This thing's totally loaded. It's a really, really great bag, and so we're going to go over all of that today. First off was the hog hunt. I had a great time. It was great to just get outside and be in nature and kind of clear your head, get away from the computer, the cell phone, and all of that stuff. That's just a great thing to do at least once a year if you can. On this particular trip, it rained. It wasn't supposed to rain, of course, and it did. It poured. So as soon as I got to my campsite, it was raining. So I had to sit in the truck for a little while and wait for it to quit raining. It quit raining for a little while, and I got out. I got my tent set up, got all my gear in the tent, because I could tell that it was going to rain again. Got all that done, and I still had a little bit of time before it started raining again, and I started gathering some firewood and things. Even though it was wet, I started looking for stuff that I could get together. And being in Florida, we get a lot of the palmetto fronds that get dried out, and they're great tender when they're dry. But what I did is just shook them off really good and piled them up so that the top ones would sort of shed the water off the ones that were going to be on the lower end, so that I'd still be able to get a fire going later if I got a window without any rain, so I could cook the dinner that I'd brought to make. So I did that, got all of the firewood and everything gathered up, and put by the little fire pit. I went to one of the Florida Wildlife Management areas, which allows you to go hunting there and camping. And if you've got the wildlife management stamp, you don't have to pay for the camping or anything like that, even if they have one of the little drop boxes where you're supposed to put the cash in and leave it. I got all of that done before it started raining again. And then by the time I got the camp set up, got my firewood gathered up, and because of the initial rain that had slowed me down on the initial setup, by the time I'd done all of that, it was too late. It was getting too dark, and I wasn't able to go out and look for any hogs that evening. Then it started raining, so I had to get in the tent for a little while. It finally stopped again. I got out. I had taken some cotton balls, dipped those in wax prior to leaving. This is something that I keep in my bug out bag for a fire starter. And some of the things I'm going to talk about later in the bag that I'm reviewing actually has some commercially manufactured wet fire bricks that are great for starting a fire when things are wet. But if you've got more time than money, this is one of those things that you can make, and you can take cotton balls, dip them in candle wax, especially if you've got some old candles that are getting near the end of their life. span. You can put those in a hot water if it's a candle in a little glass container. You can put the little glass container in boiling water, of course, not all the way up to the top of it, and melt the wax in there, and then just dip your cotton balls in there and get those saturated with the wax. And no matter how wet it is outside, those things will burn for a couple of minutes. So if you've got anything that's even remotely close to being dry enough to burn, they'll get it dried out enough and get a little bit of a fire started there so you can start putting some other items on top of the fire to get it going. So that's what I did. I got that going in a little wad of the palm fronds, the dried out palm fronds that I'd taken. And I just shook them off really good, shook all the water off of them, and then bundled them up into little bundles and took some of the leaves of the palm frond and wrapped it around each other and sort of made a little bundle out of it. Then put the cotton ball underneath that with the wax in it, lit it up. I had a fire in no time. I put a few more fronds on there and then started adding some slightly larger sticks and finally got a nice big log dried out enough to actually get a good little fire going, even though it was wet. And then I'd taken some soup from home, some homemade soup that I had from home, and I just put that in the mess kit and warmed it up and had a great dinner. And then finally, after that, I cleaned that all up and got back in the tent and, of course, started pouring again. Now, my tent stayed really, really dry. When I had first bought this tent, and this is one of the dome tents, it's an Ozark Trail that I had bought from Walmart. Now, what I did back when I first bought this tent, and this was my initial bug out tent, but this thing's about 7 or 8 pounds, so it's way, way too heavy for a bug out bag. What I had done is I took the Kiwi Camp Dry that I had bought from Outdoor World, Bass Pro Shop, and I think I bought two cans of that, and I just completely saturated that tent with this. And it's what it is. It's a real heavy duty water repellent. And that was about, I'd say, 7 years ago when I did that. And 7 years later, it repelled the water with absolutely no problem. And this is the second time I've had that tent out in the water too. So, one time before when I had that tent out, it rained. It didn't pour like it did on this hog hunting trip, but, it absolutely poured on this trip and, it stayed bone dry inside. So, Kiwi heavy duty water repellent Camp Dry. I highly recommend it. And I had also taken out of two cans, I used about 1.5 on the tent, and then the rest I used on my boots and my wife's boots, so our camping boots, to help them be a little bit more water repellent. So that helps too if you're just walking through wet grass or if it's raining outside or whatever. It keeps your feet dry. Of course, if you step in a big deep puddle, it's not going to do you any good because the water is going to seep in around the tongue of the boot. So keep that in mind. We're going to take a quick break and we'll be right back. KD Armor offers affordable body armor, including level 3 trauma plates made of AR-500 steel. They can endure multiple rounds from pistols and rifles up to 7.62 NATO. Their plates are available with Rhino Linings coatings to reduce spa. Go to katiearmor.com. That's CATIArmor.com today. So after dinner, it started raining again. So that pretty much extinguished my fire. So I had to get back in the tent, got out my shortwave radio and played with that for a little while. Which it's a great time for that because there's no TV, there's no computer, there's no cell phone service out there. So it's a great time to play around with your bug out bag electronics equipment. So I got my shortwave out and played around with that for a little while, got some music to listen to, and then it finally stopped raining again. And it was still somewhat early, and I wanted to try to keep a fire going because that's one of the things that helps keeps the critters away, because they're all afraid of fire. So that's a great way to, if you're bugging out and you're out in the woods somewhere, fires are a great thing to help keep away whatever type of critters might be around. And here in Florida, we've got a wide array of critters, and a lot of them can be hostile. We've got coyotes, we've got bears, we've got alligators, panthers, and even hogs can be very, very aggressive. So there's a quite an array of things to want to keep away with a nice fire going, and also helps you see and just kind of gives you some comfort to be out there, especially when you're out there and everything's. I went camping alone, so just being out there by yourself, it's a little spooky. So just having that fire kind of helps to dispel all of that. So I had to get out and try to find a few more palm fronds to get another fire going, because I had some more of the cotton balls that were soaked in the candle wax that I keep in my bug out bag at all times. So I had my little headlamp going, which isn't very bright, but it's great for just the immediate area. And then I had my Nebo Red Line, which is a really nice looking flashlight, and it's not super cheap. And I had that in my pocket just in case I needed something for a little bit more light. So I saw a couple of eyes back over behind a little group of trees, and of course with bears, panthers, alligators, hogs, and coyotes, I was very curious to see what kind of critter that might be. So I got my Nebo Red Light out and hit the button, and nothing. It didn't come on. So I gave it a couple of shakes, and it finally did come on, and the critter turned out to be a possum, so it wasn't quite as bad as it could have been. But it was a great time, and that's why I really recommend getting out and taking all of your bug out gear out to the woods and use this stuff, because you're gonna find out what works, you know, what's been hyped up, what everybody else loves, but then you get it out there in the woods and it doesn't work. For a possum, it wasn't quite such a big deal that it didn't come on. But I'll tell you what, this thing's never going in the woods with me again. Now, I told that story to Mike Haler over at Survival Bags Inc. And when he sent me this bag to review, he also was kind enough to stick a couple of flashlights, which actually aren't in this bag, but that he also sells over at Survival Bags Inc. for me to check out and review also. One of them was the Mini Mag Light, which is kind of it's probably comparably priced to the Nebo Red Line. It's a nice little light, and I think it sells for around $20-25. And I think he's got those at Survival Bags Inc. It's a great little light, and a lot of law enforcement people carry this. He says this is what he carries, and of course he was we had him on the show recently, and he told us that, you know, he was a Marine, he's been a police officer, he's been an EMT, so you know he's been around all of the guys that carry all the biggest, baddest, greatest gear. And this is what he carries. He claims it's very, very dependable. And of course, I've played around with it a little bit, and I've had absolutely no problems with it. We'll have to get it out there in the woods to give it the trial by fire. But I believe him, and it seems like a really, really nice little light. Now, that's kind of the entry-level light. If you wanted to spend a little bit more, he also sent me the Surefire G2X Pro. And I absolutely love this. So this is the thing that sits on my nightstand now instead of the Nebo Red Line. Because if I ever hear somebody coming in the door, I know that's not a possum. And I don't want to have a flashlight that I have to shake to make it come on. So I'm sticking to this Surefire. This thing gets the best reviews on Amazon and everywhere else. Of course, Mike sells these over at Survival Bags Inc. as well. It's got the Nitrilon body, which is sort of like a composite plastic body, which is great if you ever had to hold, you know, do something with both hands and you weren't able to hold the flashlight with your hands and you had to hold it with your teeth. Having that plastic body instead of a metal body is going to be so much more comfortable to hold with your teeth than holding a metal flashlight. The Surefire, it's got two different modes, and you tap it one time for low mode, which puts out 15 lumens, which is kind of just enough light to see in your little general area. And then you double tap it for 320 lumens, which is very, very bright. And, you know, this will really, really light up a room. It's just so far in my experience, is a great flashlight. And this is definitely going to be what's going to be in my pocket from now on when I'm camping or doing anything where I'm anticipating needing a flashlight. So back to the camping trip. It ended up raining all night, and other than a few sort of really loud downpours that were beating on the tent and woke me up a couple of times, I slept really, really great. And what I had underneath underneath my sleeping bag to just make it a little bit more comfortable is a yoga mat. And, you know, they're very thin. They don't weigh much, but it just gives you that little bit of extra padding to make you not lying on a really hard ground. So that was a great thing to have, to just give a little bit of cushion, and it doesn't take up a whole lot of extra room. Of course, I don't keep that in my bug out bag because that stuff's not going to be important if you're ever having to really, really move fast. And back to the tent, what I have in my bug out bag, rather than this big four-person dome tent that I use for camping, is a little bivy tent, and it only weighs about 2.5 pounds, and it's camouflage as opposed to blaze orange, which my dome tent is. So, you know, if you're having to bug out, you never know who you're going to have to be trying to avoid. So, and you never, and having that a little bit less weight of that 2.5 pound tent instead of that 8 pound, 7 pound, dome tent is going to be a big factor as far as being able to move fast and get some distance between you and whoever might be pursuing you. So I got up the next morning. I pulled the tent down. I got my breakfast going, which I had to gather up some more brush and shake off the water and get another one of my little cotton ball wax fire starters out and get another fire going. So I built 3 fires with those things in the rain, and they just worked like a charm. It's an absolutely fantastic thing, and it's so easy to make. And with having that those palm fronds, and wherever you happen to be, you probably have something that's gonna be very light, very dry, and hopefully you can just kind of shake off the excess water. And with a couple of those little cotton balls with the wax, you should be able to get a fire going. Then I shook off my tent, got as much of the excess moisture off of that before I rolled it up. And then I also had a tarp underneath of it, which may have also helped to keep me dry. And putting a tarp underneath your tent will help keep a little bit of the cold out, especially if you're camping out where you're on frozen ground. And also helps keep some of the moisture and all of that. It acts as a block for that, just a little something extra between you and the bottom of the tent. So definitely recommend that. Of course, for your bug out bag, once again, a big, huge tarp like that is going to be extra weight. So I haven't done it yet, but what I plan on doing is getting that little bivy tent out and setting it up in the backyard and getting some more of the Kiwi Camp Dry and spraying that thing down really good, because it does work so good. And, you know, it rains and, you know, you have to keep yourself dry, and that's part of the shelter and protecting yourself from hypothermia is staying dry in the elements. So that's a great investment. So I'm going to be getting another can of that stuff, and then probably also going back over my shoes with whatever happens to be left out of the can, since that little bivy tent is such a small thing. But I'll probably also do the bottom of that bivy tent too, since I won't be anticipating having a tarp with me if I ever have to use it. Then I got my bow out of the truck, went out on the trail, looked around to see what I could find. My bow is a Bear Outbreak compound bow. It's a great bow. I love it. It's a nice looking bow too. I did see one hog, but he was probably 100 yards away, so obviously there's no way to take that shot with a bow, and he was on the move too, so I just kind of saw him as he was crossing a little path and going into the brush. Now, if you're anywhere where you're looking for hogs, there's a few things that you can look for to tell you if you're in the vicinity. Of course, one of the big things is always going to be their poop. So looking for hog poop, and it's going to depend on what they're eating. In this particular area, they were eating some little berries that sort of look like poke berries, and I just saw it all over the place, so I know that there was hogs all over this area, and they weren't very well digested, and you could still pretty much tell what type of berries they were. Saw a lot of that. Depending on where you're at, you can look for wallows, which is going to be places where the hogs have gotten in the mud to wallow around to cool themselves off, because they don't have sweat glands and they can't cool themselves off like other creatures can through sweat. And so one of the things they do to regulate their body temperature, especially when it's hot, is they'll get in the mud and a little puddle of mud, and they'll wallow around in it, and you'll be able to see this sort of big area where they've killed all the grass and everything around it, where they've been wallowing around in that mud. One of the other things you're going to see anytime you're around in an area where hogs are is where they've been rooting through the ground looking for bugs and worms and other things like that, because hogs are omnivores. They'll eat pretty much anything. They'll eat bugs, they'll eat meat, they'll eat vegetables, they'll eat just about anything there is. Like I said, the poke berries, evidently that's something in this area that they really, really like. And then also, if you're in an area where they're wallowing, you'll see where they rub. And what they'll do is they'll get on up against the tree and either rub the mud off or try to itch themselves, and they'll leave like muddy markings on the tree. So that'll also show you where they've been. And then you'll see sort of places, especially in like tall grass and things, you'll see places where they bed down. And that's just going to be big areas where the grass is all smushed down. And then you'll see their trails. You'll see the trails where they've kind of cut through, because they'll kind of make, they'll have little habits, and they'll keep going back over the same areas over and over and over, and cutting through the trails. And then also on the trip, I saw a huge otter, probably the biggest otter I've ever seen in my life. And it was just kind of like very unexpected. I was right by a swamp. So that's where the hogs here go in to cool off, is that shallow water of that swamp. So I didn't see a whole lot of wallows, but I did see a lot of areas where they'd been rooting, and a lot of the scat, and I saw a hog. So I knew I was in the right area. I just unfortunately didn't get close enough to get a shot on this particular trip. And then I also saw about a 6-foot gator too. So I was definitely in the land of the wild. So it's definitely one of those places that you want to make sure you've got a good flashlight if you're going to get out there. So definitely make some time. Of course, this is winter now, so probably for most people in America, it's probably too cold to get out there too much. But when the spring rolls around, get your gear, get it outside, and check it out, because it's a great way to figure out what works and what doesn't, and find out what your particular needs are, and make sure that you've got everything in there, because it's also going to show you what you're missing in your bag, especially if you just go out there with just whatever your bug out bag is. Which brings us to our next topic, bug out bags. Now, I'm going to be reviewing the Urban Operator Survival Bug Out Bag today, which I said Mike Heiler over at Survival Bags Inc. sent me, and it's a fantastic bag. I think he sells this for $269. Which this has got some really, really good stuff in it. So it would be tough to put this bag together yourself. And of course, you'd spend hours and hours trying to find all the different components and put them all in there. And if you heard his interview back last month, you'll remember, and like I just mentioned before, he was a Marine, he was an EMT, he was a police officer. So he kind of knows all of this gear, so he's really put good stuff in there, and he's put a lot of the stuff in there that he uses himself personally. And this is really, really great stuff, especially for people that are really busy. They've got you work 60 hours a week, and you just don't have time to go to the camping store and dig all of this stuff up and research it and find out what's the best thing and then pack it into a bag. And if you just don't have time for all of that stuff and you just need to get something, this is a great bag. This is a great entry-level bag, and it's covered all of the basics. For starters, I'm going to talk about the bag itself. The bag itself is a Fox Tactical Field Operators Action Pack. It's 22 inches by 16 by 9 inches. Very, very roomy bag. It's nice, thick nylon. I'd say it's probably 600D, just guessing, because I don't see the specs on that. It's got very, very high quality zippers. A bag's only as good as the zippers. If it's got really cheap zippers that stick or pull apart or catch on stuff, then the whole bag's junk. So definitely, when you're looking for a bag, look for something with really good zippers, and this has the good zippers. It's got multiple ways to carry it. It's got a top carry handle on the sides of each bag, on the left side and the right side. It's got a carry handle, so you could actually use this bag for a travel bag. It's a very, very good bag. And I'd say the bag itself, if you were just buying it, is probably a $60 bag. It's got food and water in it. It's got two MREs in it. So one of them, I think, was a chicken and rice, and the other one was like a vegetarian chili. And these are the deluxe MREs that have the warmers in them, so that, you know, if you are bugging out, you've at least got one hot meal there in that MRE. And there's two of them, so if there's two of you, you've each got one of those. And then it's also got two of the 240 calorie food bar packets, which, you know, these things, looking at them, you're thinking, oh, it's probably not too good. And to be honest with you, I haven't busted one open yet to try it out to see if it's any good, if it tastes like anything. But I mean, it's basically a cookie. You know, it's got a whole lot of sugar in it, so I know that I'll be able to eat it. Anything that's got that much sugar in it, I'm not going to have any problem, especially if I'm trying to stay alive. I'll be able to eat that, and it'll keep you alive. And that's what it's designed to do, is to give you the, and it's got a lot of fat in it too. So, you know, that's high energy, and that's getting a lot of bang for your buck in a very small package, if you're on the run. So probably not the best thing to eat, health-wise. And I don't know what it tastes like, but I'm sure it will keep you alive. And anything with that much sugar in it, like I said, it's not going to be that bad. So I'll be able to eat that. And, you know, like I said, that's something to eat on the go. And then you've got the two nice MREs that you can sort of have, sit down and have a nice meal if it's you and somebody else that you're bugging out with, you and your spouse, or however that happens to be. It's got 12 of the emergency drinking water packets, which I think comes out to about a quart and a half. They're 4.22 ounces each, which, you know, you've got some water in your bag. You know, water is very heavy, and a gallon of water weighs 8 pounds. So just carrying 1 gallon, which is what you would need to stay alive for 2 days, is going to really, really weigh down your bug out bag. But just having a little bit to get you going is great. And then in addition to that, it also has a Life Straw, which is a very small personal water filter that you can just stick in a stream or a lake or anything and just suck right through it, and that's going to filter out all the cryptosporidium and all the really nasty stuff that'll take you out. So between the water that you've got in the bag and your Life Straw, you're going to be able to get enough water to keep you alive for 72 hours, which is the purpose of a bug out bag. You know, it's not really something to restart society. It's something to get you out of harm's way and get you to a place of safety and to keep you alive for 3 days. And hopefully you're able to get to a better place in 3 days. You know, of course, there's a completely other type of planning that goes on for what comes after that. But that's the purpose of a bug out bag. And also, as I've said before, a bug out bag is also a bug in bag. So if you're trapped in your home for whatever reason, there's a chemical spill, or a dirty bomb goes off near your house, or there's rioting or whatever, if you've got 72 hours worth of supplies, food, water, medical, and all of that kind of thing to bug out, you've also got all that stuff to bug in. So it's a bug in bag as well. And then the next component of the bag I'm going to talk about is the knife that's in it. This is probably the star of the show. I mean, the bag itself is really, really nice. Like I said, it's the Fox Tactical, very, very high quality. But the knife is the Columbia River Knife and Tool, and the model number is M1612ZLEK. Now, this one is just absolutely fantastic. What I've been carrying for my everyday carry has been a Gerber Kiowa, which has got the serrated blade on the back and the Tonto blade on the front. And that's exactly what this Columbia River knife has. Now, what this has in addition to my Kiowa is it has a double locking mechanism. So you've got the thumb lock, and then you've also got a little trigger lock on the back of the blade too. So you've got to push both of those to fold the knife down. So it makes it super, super safe. It also has a seatbelt cutter on it. So this is sort of like a rescue tool that you can use for, you know, somebody. A lot of times when people have car wrecks, their seatbelt, either the release button isn't accessible or it gets jammed, and you got to cut that out. And then having that little seatbelt cutter is so much faster than having to saw through it with the serrated blade of a knife. And then it also has on the bottom a glass breaker, which is pretty small, and I've been carrying this thing in my pocket now for about a month, and so far I haven't poked myself with it or hurt myself with the little pointed glass breaker on the bottom. So I absolutely love this. I'd been carrying something similar in my truck, sort of a auto rescue tool, and it's the big, huge Smith & Wesson knife that I bought several years ago, which is Smith & Wesson knives are garbage. I had a little one that had the that blade like I like, with the tonto tip and the serrated blade on the back, and all the screws just started falling out of it, and it basically fell apart. And I didn't really, I'm not a heavy user. I don't use the thing, you know. I open boxes with it, and you know, cut some rope, cut some string, cut some zip ties here and there. You know, 4 or 5 times a week I might use it. So I don't beat my gear up. I'm pretty easy on it. So for that thing to fall apart, for me, it's absolutely junk. So I would never get another Smith & Wesson knife. I'm sure their firearms are great, but I think that they just, you know, sold out for their name and put it on a bunch of junk. Otherwise, the Gerber Kiowa that I had been carrying for so long, I loved it, and I've never had any problems with it, and it's just a great little knife. But because this has all the features that I loved in the Kiowa, plus the seatbelt cutter and the glass breaker, you know, now I'm carrying this little Columbia River. And this thing sells on the Columbia River website for $90. So you can imagine, if he's got a $260 bag and it's already got a $90 knife in it, this is a real value. And like I said, I'm sure the bag itself is probably a $60, $70 bag. So, and then you put all of the survival stuff in there. It's really, really a great deal. So, I love the knife, and that's my new everyday carry knife now. Now, he does sell those alone. If you just want that knife, he sells those on, Survival Bags Inc. And he sells them at a much deeper discount than what Columbia River sells them for. I think he sells them for around $55 or $60. So that's a huge discount off of what they're selling them for at Columbia River. On to the next item. He has in the bag, we also get a Smith's Pocket Pal X2. This is a sharpener and survival tool. I've got one of these little sharpeners that's a similar sharpener in my bug out bag, but it's just a sharpener. And of course, when you're doing bug out bags, the more things you can get into one tool, the better off you are. So it's got the coarse sharpener for, you know, sharpening your knife up, and then it's got the fine edge for the fine sharpener for putting a nice edge on it. And then it's got the little stick on it for the serrated section of your knife, which all of my knives have a serrated section, because I think that's so important to have. And the sharpener I have also has that. But what mine doesn't have is this has a whistle built into it, and then it's got a fire starter, and it's got a compass. So I have all of that stuff in my bag. But I have all of that stuff, and it's all these different pieces. So that's all stuff that's taking up more room. And while they're all small things, they're adding weight still. So to have all of this stuff in this one thing is really, really ingenious. And I haven't taken it out yet to try it, but it looks like it's very, very well made. And I can just look at the compass right now and tell you that it's working. So I would imagine the rest of it works. A whistle's not a super complex piece of machinery, so I'm sure that works. And you know, most fire starters are just the magnesium bar, and you just have to get a spark on it. Next item that's in the bag is a packet of Wet Fire, and this is commercially manufactured stuff that I was talking about. And this is going to act like those little cotton balls that I was talking about that I've got the wax on that I made myself. So this is a manufactured thing, so that you don't have to make all of that mess and make all that stuff, especially, like I said earlier, if you're somebody that's working 60 hours a week, you know, to make a little project like that is very time consuming, and all of these things are time consuming when you're in prepping, and especially for new preppers, sometimes you just need to get some stuff together and get a bag so that you have something, and this is a great thing. And I haven't tried these out yet, but I'm sure it's a great product, and it's called Wet Fire, and it's a 12 pack, so you've got 12 of the little individual fire starters for getting a fire going when it's wet, because believe me, from my last camping trip that I just got back from, it happens. Now, this also has a Survive Outdoors Longer SOL hybrid pack, which is a survival kit, first aid, and gear repair. And it's got a little headlamp, like I said, like I was talking about earlier, which I was using to gather my firewood and extra brush after the stuff that I had gathered before it got dark got rained out, so I had to go get new kindling. It's got a small survival kit in it, which has EMT shears, bandages, gauze, tape. So that's a nice looking thing. It's got some it's got a signaling mirror. It's got another whistle in it. It's got another compass in it. It's got a survival blanket, and it's got duct tape, which is absolutely a prepper's best friend is duct tape. And what I've done for my bug out bag is I took just a regular roll of duct tape. I took the serrated edge of my knife and cut the cardboard core out of the duct tape so that I could fold the duct tape flat, so that when I put that in my backpack, it takes up a lot less room. But for something that's pre-packed like this, this has got just a little roll, and it's just rolled around itself, so very, very compact, very, very small. And this is a nice looking kit, and this is probably going to end up being one of our giveaway items in our next giveaway. We're going to probably, a lot of this stuff is probably going to get portioned out and given away in March when the Days of Noah book 2 comes out. So every time I have a new book that comes out, we always do a big survival gear giveaway to celebrate that. And so a lot of the stuff's going to go in that giveaway. So definitely be listening in March to find out when that is and how to enter. Now, the bag also has a nice big bag of hygiene stuff. You got a toothpaste, toothbrush, dental floss, which dental floss can be used for other things, tripwires, fishing, stuff like that. It's not super strong, but you know, you've got it. And while we're talking about cordage, it does have a nice, it's got, I think, 100 feet of paracord in it. It's very, very nice quality paracord with the 7 inner strands that you can use for tripwires, fishing, and all of that. But this kit has a little fishing kit and a little metal tin in it, which is great. And that's something that I keep in my personal bug out bag. And of course, like everything else, I put that together myself. So it took a lot of time and a lot of searching, a lot of figuring out how I was going to get it small. What I did is I just took a spool of fishing line. I got some relatively high test fishing line, and I stuck all my hooks and bobbers and lures in the little empty compartments in between, because the fishing line's got a little spool hole in the middle, and then it's got four little sort of separators that sort of form these little compartments inside the spool itself. So I just stuffed everything inside the spool and then just put some duct tape around the whole thing to hold that stuff in, and then whenever I need it, I can just pull the duct tape off and pull out the bobber and the hooks and the lures and all of that if I want to make some sort of a fishing contraption. So this has all of that stuff, and like I said, if you're busy, you know, and even if you're not busy, you know, everybody's got to work, and you've got all this other stuff going on. And by the time you're making your little fire starters and putting together all your stuff and putting together a little fishing kit, it takes time. So if you don't have time for that, this is a great solution for that, because it's already in there and it's already pre-packed and it's got everything you need for that. So that little fishing kit is probably also going to be one of the giveaway items in March. So if you'd like something like that, make sure you're listening in March, and you might win it. We also have a wire saw, which is very, very light and compact. What I've got in my bag is I've just got a little plastic-handled serrated hacksaw, and it's good, but it takes up a little space, and this little wire saw is just just a one wire and two big pulleys so that you can pull it back and forth. So this thing would absolutely take a lot less space than what I've got in my bag right now. So highly recommend this. And then it's got three N95 masks, and it also has a shower in the bag, which is a nice big cleaning cloths. I keep in my bug out bag, I keep the little wet wipes, which are great for all kinds of things, but having this slightly bigger cloth is great because those little bathroom cleanup wipes they're small, and if you're trying to sort of clean up after you've been out and sweating all day and maybe gotten dirty and gotten muddy and collecting firewood and all of that stuff, you have to use a lot of those things, and you're going through them fast. So having something big like the shower and the bag cloths it's a great idea, and I'm looking forward to trying those out. So that's probably something that's going to end up in my bag. So probably won't be giving that one away. One of the issues I had on my camping trip is that because it was so wet, I took my boots off, and then I was walking around in the damp grass with my flip-flops when I was getting the fire going and everything. And when your feet are wet like that, they end up stinking. So I had to use several wet wipes to get my feet cleaned up. And I wish I would have had the shower in the bag for that. I'm sure it would have worked a lot better and a lot faster and been a lot more efficient. So I didn't cover everything in the bag, but I did try to highlight all of the big stuff, and hopefully that helps. And if you're looking for a good entry-level bag that's really got all the bases completely covered, this is a fantastic bag, and you're probably going to spend that much anyway, even putting it together yourself, and you'll save a lot of time. And like I said, you're getting the gear that a Marine, law enforcement, EMT guy has put together. So it's somebody that knows what they're doing. And like I said, some of the stuff in here is absolutely top quality stuff. And it's a great bag for the money. And if you want to check that out, from PrepperRecon.com, you can just click the big black and yellow banner at the top of the page, the Survival Bags Inc., and then just look for the Urban Operator Survival Bag. It's a great bag, and it's great value. So hope you guys enjoyed the show. God bless, and happy prepping.
Are we living in a time of which there is more prophetic writings than of any period in history? Noah Parker, like many in the United States, has been asleep at the wheel. During his complacency, the founding precepts of America have been slowly, systematically destroyed by a conspiracy that dates back hundreds of years. The signs can no longer be ignored. Watch through the eyes of Noah Parker and his family as a global empire takes shape. Ancient writings are fulfilled, and the last days fall upon the once great United States of America. The Days of Noah, Book 1. Conspiracy by Mark Goodwin is a fast-paced fiction thriller which looks at how modern conspiracies could play into biblical prophecy concerning end times. Buy The Days of Noah in paperback, Kindle, or audio edition at Amazon.com today.